Thank you very much. First of all, I have to make a confession. I'm actually officially old. I have surpassed 50% of my life expectancy. As an average German, I would kind of turn 78. I'm 41. So by actually being old now, I actually had to look around, and I was quite frightened and shocked what I saw. With that in mind, I actually have to tell you that we have to start a revolution. We have to start a revolution against ourselves. Because there is this wonderful moment of retirement that is up into the air at a moment of our, when we become 65 or somewhere around there. But after that kind of beautiful moment of having a long-term vacation, we actually end up in a place we don't want to be. And we all know that nobody wants to be alone at any given time in our life. We also don't want to depend on any other people. We want to be self-determined. And we also want know that we do not want to be stored away. But so now here's my question. Why do we in America still have 17,000 nursing homes, and there are at least 17,000 reasons to not move into any one of them? And my question is to my own architectural profession is, why do we still dare to build buildings that become hazard towards our own selves? And even worse, we build cities, they do the same, they trap us. We all are aging. There's nothing really mysterious about it. Yeah, it happens to every one of us at any given time. And when we look at statistics, it's here we start out with 100 people, and over 100 years, basically most of us drop dead at a certain given time. And it also happens that actually for example, we're not going to be able to drive a car anymore at a certain point. So here, for example, when we're 70 years old, 50% likeliness we're not going to have a car. So why do we still live in a place where we depend on one of them? The same thing is also, my slides are faster, or my clicker, come on. Yep. The same is also with kind of pure statistics about the difficulties which are coming up into our lives. It will be very hard at some point to bath, dress, eat, use a chair, go to the bathroom, and so on. And all of that is nothing mysterious. We can look at the data, we can look at our parents, all of that will happen. And the question is, why don't we really prepare for this? And the last point is also, it happens that at some point, this is where we live and how we live, it happens that we actually have to move into a nursing home. And the fact is that 1/3 of all Americans will end up in a nursing home. And the average of time in a nursing home spent is 650 days. And that is what we have to declare war against. We have to change that. And how do we do this? We, in a collection of architects, we started a project which we call BOOM. And we looked into social media to find actually a group of architects which are extremely progressive, architects who can collaborate, but even more important so, we looked for architects who have never done anything in the realm of aging, because we wanted to have architects to work with us with fresh eyes. And the great thing about it is that we found amazing companies working with us. So Dillo Scofidio Renfro, you guys know them, they did the High Line in New York, for example. We worked together with Low Tech, which doing the Puma cities throughout the country. We're working with Sado Vuga from Slovenia, they're building beautiful stadiums and apartment buildings. L2, young people from Israel. Jürgen Meyer, a spectacular architect from Germany. Joel Sander, also from here in New York. Madeline Ginz, you should check her out. She's creating architecture against death, all about longevity principles. Surface design as landscape designers. And we also found ourselves, the company is called Holwich Kushner, HWKN. And all of us, we got together into a workshop mode. And we were meeting a couple of times with a realistic site in Palm Springs. And in these workshops, first of all, we just realized that there is the first inherent problem about us dealing with anything that relates to aging, because we always talk about the elderly. And truth of the fact is, actually, There are no elderly in this world. I have never met an elderly. I can ask everyone in here, see, do you know any elderly? I don't. Only thing is, I know all people. And even more important is, there are just people. There is nothing different. And what they want is, they want to live the life they want. Exactly what we want to do too. So to research what that means for us is we had to break it down into a couple of principles. And number one, it's about individuality. And it's so fun, I googled around individuality and I looked for all the people in pictures and it just doesn't exist. So I had to use this kind of young kids here to present that kind of idea. So there's not one group of people, they're individuals. And there are many groups, equally groups as in the 30s, 40s, 50s, any kind of age. And everyone to want to be self-determined, to be able to allow that people be in the driving seat and that they can make the right choices and their own choices. And it needs to be meaningful. It cannot become silly at the moment where we just start to play bingo at a certain point of our lives when we have never played it before. And and we have to really tie that back into kind of this idea of meaning in all the things we do. And obviously, there are many things that starts already from working, but it can go into volunteering or any kind of work that is kind of recognized or activity that's recognized within our society. And then the connection to the community as core element and supporting each other, and a social exchange. And the beauty is, for example, here in Japan, they had found a system in the 80s at the moment where they had financial problems. When they had their big recession, that people could not take care of their older parents anymore. So they invented a social point system where you could clean the streets in your neighborhood and you could exchange them that the neighbors of your parents could help them. And after the recession, they tried to get rid of that system again, and it was so popular that people boycotted basically the elimination, and it's still there. Because they argue it's so much better to get help from your neighbor than you get help from a nurse. And then safety and security, and that is just a no-brainer. We have to bring that in on every one of our ways of thinking. And strong roots. So what we started out then to do, because we're architects, we have to design something, we created a retirement community. We first of all, we took out the retirement, because who came up with this idea? Maybe they have a wrong job. We certainly don't need to retire if we do the things we want to do, and we can do that as long as we can. And so we turned it into an empowerment community. But the question is how we do that. It sounds all a little bit too idealistic, but it's actually quite easy. We have to just use common life as a principle, the way we all live our lives today, and we have to add, subtract, and kind of swap a couple of things to make that happen. And in our project, we're doing that in Palm Springs, somewhere in a very kind of central kind of urban area. Very important that we don't think about any development outside of kind of an urban fabric because it needs to be integrated, it cannot be isolated. And with this kind of 10 architects, the beauty was we had 10 creative minds. They actually, we just let them loose. They came up with their own 10 different visions for this kind of new idea of communal living, and that all together as 10 visions integrated into a bold new kind of community. So that actually all of these kind of housing ideas were not based on one idea how people should live. It actually really reflected the way how we could live in many different fashions. And when you just flip through a couple of images from Ruth and Donner, for example, used a little bit kind of very dense urban streets with buildings kind of integrated with courtyards. That is kind of a loft housing, and it's suburbia, so this is one of the typologies. But all of these kind of examples here just presented new ideas how we could kind of live again with aging in mind, but make that very varied and very, of course, integrated. Again, and nothing was kind of a stigma in itself. And some of the examples became really beautiful. For example, here at the project from Jürgen Meyer, he combined three houses into one and he opened the apartments within each other, so that you could have windows where you can relate to each other when you want. Otherwise, you can just close the curtain. So again, so to enhance this idea of local communities. Or in our case, we created this kind of 22 homes together with a central core as kind of a key community. But then even more important was that the organization of the apartments does not really believe anymore that it needs to be the husband and the wife. It could be the husband and another husband. It could be also a husband, it could be childs or friends. All these kind of configurations are new ideas how we can live together, and our floor plans really have to be able to reflect that, so that you have individual entrances into your almost studio apartments, collective spaces, communal spaces, all of these kind of things, really rethinking the way how the society thinks want to live and can live in itself. And then the transformations where the bedroom, of course, also can be infused with medical kind of support system. And we call it actually stealth care, because nobody wants to really get a healthcare kind of component come to the house. It can all come in informal, supportive, but not with like a nurse with kind of the dress in whatever kind of fashion is being established today. It could be just a hip neighbor, or it could be also in whatever kind of a service that just supports, but it's not kind of blatant up into your face. And then, of course, we believe that all the different bathrooms and so on really need to be truly compliant to universal design. And I always mention that kind of story that it came out that actually 50% of dementia patients have dementia because of the lack of drinking water. And when there was a study, why don't they drink water? And it's because they're afraid of going to the bathroom. So missing out on a grab bar can cause dementia. So there's an architectural solution for some cases of a medical condition. So important to keep that in mind. And of course, we can just add services and conveniences. And the beauty is today that, of course, technology, finally with the iPhone, became so personal. So it becomes really a new kind of a translator and a communicator between the architecture, the buildings, the people within the buildings. And we're actually working on kind of a new app, which is called Ad Hoc, which creates this kind of informal connectivity between people inside of walls, so that we kind of reconnect people now with all this kind of interesting new communication devices. And then all of that is really infused with everything that we want from a city and an active urban lifestyle. And all of that was also intended to be extremely architecturally refined and impressive, because what we want to do is that we also want to fight age discrimination through the excellence in design. Because these buildings do not need to look boring. They should attract, they should trigger interest and curiosity, so that there is actually an active communication and interest between also the community at large and the people within the community itself. And then all the kind of more classic tools, of course, gardens, amenities, for example, a hotel, bed and breakfast, business center, very important, so that there's always an infrastructure available that supports basically the life, the way we want to live our lives in all kind of different fashions from all kind of different amenities. And then in our case, we also designed a nursing home, because we do need one, and we call it much more of kind of a wellness center. And we created the most dangerous nursing home on the planet to make sure that it counters everything that we believe what a nursing home should be. It's also a sustainability concept. It's actually a heat chimney that helps to naturally just cool the building just through air draft. But we use it also that people can just climb up. And here, when you're in a wheelchair, you hang out here. You have the best view over the desert. And a mountain climber just comes over, says hi. And these are this kind of interactivities which really make a difference in everyone's life at the moment where you're actually kind of really in that challenged condition. Yeah, so this is basically a very short kind of introduction into this one project we're doing in Palm Springs at Boom. But these kind of ideas can actually become much smaller. They can also become much bigger. They can also become horizontal or vertical. And we're looking into many kind of applications right now. For example, a pixelated landscape that is a project we're working on in Spain. That is also age-related with kind of a new idea of an urban scheme here. Or in virtual conditions, we're working on with a developer in New York about really changing the paradigm of the typical tower. The typical tower, you have the amenities below. Here are the most expensive apartments. But when you want to empower the community again to talk, to help each other, and to really live together, you have to turn the tower around and put all the amenities on the top, because that should become the prime real estate for the people to get together again and to help each other and to enjoy life. And all of this, these are quick sketches we're doing right now here. It's of course kind of early ideas, but just this, what I want to communicate here, that all the kind of things we were learning in our BOOM project, that can take all kind of different scales. And even when we have to design a nursing home, which is one of our commissions, where we then actually take the nursing home, the nursing out of the equation, it becomes a living home. We take exactly the same principles of urban infrastructure, even within the kind of core of the building itself, individuality, community, all of these kind of elements become basically valid on all the kind of different scales. And then we come also to the metropolis, where if we think it further, it becomes the Geropolis, and all of these kind of elements stay intact. And when we look into modernism, what happened in our world where we had the traditional housing that turned into kind of a segregation of kind of activities within our urban surrounding. In New York, it's a little bit different, but every other city has very clear like living quarters and working quarters. And what we can do is actually combine all these activities now into one single building again, so that the buildings themselves become cities, so that the range of movement and the kind of richness of activities are out just within the building and accessible on every kind of scale. And we prototyped that for Asia and Korea with my groups of students from the University of Pennsylvania. And it's of course very interesting for us as architects to finally look back at our profession, the things we do now with a new lens on, the lens on aging. That's why I'm very, very, very excited that I'm 41, finally. I'm part of the older. And what I also believe that this is really the moment of our revolution. And we do have to take it serious, because if in a few years I'm going to move into a nursing home, I know that I have failed with my own mission today. Thank you.